James Prescott Joule, the reason we use joule as a unit to quantify work, carried out several experiments using electromagnetism and electromagnetic engines, but some of his most successful ones were related to quantifying the temperature of objects and describing energy and heat. One of his most successful experiments consisted in attaching some weights to strings and pulleys and connecting them to a paddle wheel inside an insulated container of water so that no heat could leave or enter the container. He raised the weights to a quantifiable height and slowly dropped them. As they fell, the paddle wheel began to turn, stirring up the water. This friction between the paddles and the water generated heat, and with it, the temperature of the water began to increase. He effectively used quantifiable work in the form of gravitational potential energy to bring up the temperature of a substance, or in other words, to produce heat. In science and engineering, there are many different types of energy that we're interested in. Kinetic energy, from a macroscopic perspective, is the energy that is related to the motion of an object. If we know, for example, the speed and the mass of the object, we know from physics that the kinetic energy of the object is 1/2 mass velocity squared. And sure, there are exceptions, like for example when an object theoretically travels at the speed of light, the energy term would not have the 1/2 at the beginning. We also have potential energy, which is kind of like the energy that body has stored in it. Examples of this can be gravitational, like when an object is above a certain datum, and we say the height of the location of that object determines its potential energy, or elastic, like when a spring is being compressed. These two macroscopic types make up what we usually categorize as mechanical energy. We'll use a little bit of these in our calculations for some of the devices/systems we'll study in thermo, but we'll mostly focus on thermal energy. During the Zeroth Law 10-minute lecture, link below, we briefly mentioned how temperature is related to how much thermal energy a system has, specifically how much thermal vibration its molecules have. Therefore, thermal energy is categorized as kinetic energy at a microscopic level. In the same microscopic level, you'd find other types of energy like chemical, electrical, or nuclear. We talk about total internal energy when talking about the sum of all microscopic types of energy, and we use capital U as the variable for it. Now, the way we get to those mechanical energy expressions we regularly used in physics and dynamics was with the definition of work. Work is equal to the integral of F dx. For macroscopic kinetic energy, we have from Newton's second law that F equals to ma. Since the acceleration is the derivative of velocity, and dv dt can be written as dv dx times dx dt, where dx dt is velocity itself, we can write the work caused by acceleration to be the integral of what we have on the right. This is just 1/2 mv squared, or 1/2 mv2 squared minus v1 squared. For gravitational work, the force would be the weight of the object, mg. Therefore, the integral yields mgh. For elastic work, the force is minus kx, and therefore the energy is 1/2 kx squared. Remember how we established that we use lowercase letters for the variables of specific properties or properties per unit mass? It's the same here. We can write capital W for total work, or lowercase w for work per kilogram, or mass-specific work. Lowercase w for kinetic energy would be 1/2 v squared, and lowercase w for gravitational potential energy would be gh, both expressions without the mass term. When we use a dot on top of a variable, we're referring to its rate over time, meaning the amount of that variable per unit time. The rate of work, capital W dot, would therefore be mass flow rate times mass-specific work. As for units, mass flow rate would be kilograms per second, specific work would be joules per kilogram, and therefore the rate of work would have joules per second, or just watts. And how can we calculate mass flow rate if we only have the volumetric flow rate, V dot, in cubic meters per second? Well, if the substance is not compressible, meaning it has a constant density, the mass flow rate would be the density times the volumetric flow rate. This is important because energy can only be transferred to or from a system by heat transfer Q or work W, any of the types we just overviewed, so we need to be able to calculate those easily when we have an open system, That's when the mass is coming in and or out, remember? And remember that both heat and work are measured in joules.
In English units, this is slightly different.
So make sure to check one of the example links below to go over this. These two are also both path functions, meaning that the amount of heat or work we get out or have to put forth is dependent on the path it took for the system to get from one state to another, like we explained in the previous lecture, link below. One of the most important conventions in thermodynamics is the sign convention for heat and work. And yes, if you already know anything about it, it's a very silly convention. Adding heat to a system is positive, and heat coming out of a system is negative. And for work, it's the opposite. If we are putting work into the system, work is negative, and if work is being produced by the system, work is positive. This means that work in is negative and work out is positive. The reason for this convention is mostly historical. One of the first applications of thermodynamics was the heat engine, adding heat to a system to get work out of the system, so those two were assumed to be positive. There really isn't a real reason not to assume in as positive for both and out as negative for both, and it would make understanding and solving for energy values a lot easier, believe me. But unfortunately, work coming in is negative and work coming out is positive, and that's how you'll find it everywhere in the world of thermodynamics, heat transfer, and fluid mechanics. So my advice is just to get used to it as quickly as you can. Alright, so even though you've probably heard that energy cannot be created nor destroyed, only transformed, this doesn't mean that energy cannot leave a system or come into a system. The change in energy within our system, or in general within a control volume, is the change of internal energy plus the change of kinetic energy and the change in potential energy. And since this change in energy can only result from heat transfer and work coming in or out of the system, we equate this to Q net minus W net, again following the convention we just went over. And you might ask, well, but why do you assume these two are coming into the system? You have plus Q coming in and negative W also coming in. Well, we're not assuming that they are coming into the system. These signs are only there to fix what I called the silly convention earlier, and they are independent of the sign that we have for each heat or work term. If, for example, we do have work coming in, we'd put a negative sign to that value, and still keep the negative next to the W net, and end up with a positive term in our general equation. Couldn't we just write Q net plus W net and assume work in is positive, just like heat in is? Yes, we could. But again, unfortunately, with this very sensible reasoning, you would be contradicting what everyone else is already used to. So again, just remember that the work term has a negative sign in this equation. This equation is what we call the first law of thermodynamics, or the conservation of energy equation. Now, you'll learn a lot more about heat transfer when and if you take the heat transfer course. Link to that course's playlist below, by the way. But for now, just know that there are three main categories for it. You have conduction, convection, both natural and forced, and radiation. For this course, we don't really care how the heat is being transferred between bodies, volume, or substances. But just so that you are aware of this and you can actually picture how heat can come in or out of a system, the two most common types of heat transfer we'll have are conduction and convection. Conduction is when the transfer of heat passes through matter that is not moving. The matter can be liquids or gases too, but it's usually associated with solids, as liquids and gases usually start moving when regions of them change temperature, pressure, density gradients, and all of that. As an example, you can hold a metal spoon to stir pasta in boiling water, and the temperature gradient between the boiling water and everything around the spoon would cause heat to travel through the metal from the high temperature to the lower temperature. Convection is when the transfer of heat occurs through a moving fluid. Remember that fluid means liquid or gas. A cold breeze on a hot object would be an example where the heat inside the hot object is being transferred to the cold air, or in other words, an example of convection. Like I said, there's two main types of convection, natural and forced. This would be an example of forced convection, but again, for the purposes of thermodynamics only, this is not the focus. Let's take a look at a very simple example regarding the first law, or conservation of energy equation, And if you want to check more complex examples on this topic, make sure to check out the links in the description below. A paddle wheel is connected to the interior of a pot filled with water that is located on top of a stovetop burner. While the pot is on the stove, 40 kilojoules of heat moves from the burner to the water, 8.25 kilojoules of heat are lost to the surrounding air, and the paddle wheel work is measured to be 750 newton meters. What is the final energy of the system if its initial energy was 16 kilojoules? Remember to pause here to solve this problem yourself before watching the solution up next. Using the conservation of energy equation, or in other words, the first law of thermodynamics, on a control volume that only takes into consideration the water inside the pot, we see that we don't have any changes in potential energy and that any macroscopic changes of kinetic energy are probably negligible. We do know that there is heat coming in, and we know that heat coming in is positive. We have heat coming out, and heat coming out is negative. We also have work coming into the system, or being done to the system, and this is, by convention, considered negative. So W is equal to minus 0.75 kilojoules, so when we substitute it in the energy conservation equation, we keep both negative signs. And finally, the change in internal energy is the final energy, or U2, minus the initial energy, or U1. We solve for U2 to find that the final energy of the system is 48.5 kilojoules. Like I said, check out the other, more complex examples on the topics we covered here today, which are linked in the description of this video. You'll find the links to the other lectures of thermodynamics and the other engineering courses there as well. Thanks for watching!